difference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for student athletes and promoting academic excellence. Each SWAC member institution represents a high level of integrity and sportsmanship. We are the SWAC, building champions for life. In 1920, an athletic league was formed and slowly became one of the leading sports associations in the world of collegiate athletics, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for student athletes and promoting academic excellence. Each SWAC member institution represents a high level of integrity and sportsmanship. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
We welcome you back to Regions Field in Birmingham, Alabama. We started with 8 teams. Now we're down to 5. Jackson State, Texas Southern, Prairie View's been eliminated. The loser of this game will be eliminated. It will be Southern University and FAMU tomorrow at 9. Then at noon, Bama State will take on the winner of this game at 12. Glad you can join us here on the SWAC Digital Network. James Crenshaw, our producer. Dez Rogers, Lauren Sutton, Roosevelt Smith on the cameras. The Hall of Famer, Roger Cador. Coach, it's been a long haul, and here we are. It's Bethune and Grambling. Of course, these two teams met early in the tournament, in which Bethune beat Grambling in a low-scoring game, 4-3. They face Shamar Page on the mound, but Bethune will see Shamar Page in the lineup as he's playing in left field today for Grambling.
Really?
Yes, sir.
What a guy. Not DHing. He's in left.
He's in left field hitting second.
Boy, I tell you, you don't find those throwback players like that anymore.
Leek Stevens at the plate for the Wildcats. Man, yes, this game previous to this one, that FAMU eliminated Prairie View 17-1. I did not see that one coming at all. But that's what happens. Pitching gets thin. And you know what happens when that takes place. A lot of offense. It was one-sided. Panthers were eliminated. They played earlier today. Texas Southern was eliminated. Jackson State eliminated.
Well, the thing with Prairie View is that they just ran out of pitching. And I sort of suspect that could happen. And then when that happened, they took FAMU, were able to take the sail out of their wind. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So they just floated and, you know, played until they were able to get the runs and end the game in the seventh inning.
Well, obviously, Southern and FAMU will play tomorrow. Bama State will play tomorrow. And with the pitching being the way it is, you get that rest and recovery. Everybody, all hands on deck for tomorrow's action. There's a pitch swing and a miss on a pitch up and away. One out. Rudy Connor for the Tigers. He blew him away right there.
You got to be careful of that kind of pitcher who is an off-speed specialist. And, you know, he could cause problems for Cookman.
So it'll bring up the shortstop, Matthew Garcia. This is ball one. Weather's turned out to be pretty good. Once the rain moved out of here, a little on the coolish side, a little cooler than it was a couple of days ago. It was humid. Here's a chopper back to Connor. Whirls, throws, two out. Two away. It'll bring up the right fielder, Chris Patterson. 10th at bat in this tournament. We're talking about postseason stats now. He's hitting .444 with 3 runs batted in. Bethune Cookman right now hitting .268 as a squad in this postseason.
Did you request that they put Page in the lineup?
I did not. Although I was talking with Coach Pierre last night, he was here looking at the games, he did indicate that Shamar Page would be in the lineup. But
he didn't say in what capacity.
He didn't say in what capacity. You kind of assumed he wasn't going to be pitching. There's a chopper up the middle, backhanded that second, throw across, inning over. What a play. 1-2-3 inning as Jar Parker, or Jarcifer Parker, however way you want to call it, Jara Jarcifer with a jarring play right there. Look at this range, Coach.
Look like you.
Oh, no way.
Not bad. Good play right there.
No way I'm in that in any shape, form, or fashion. We'll take a break here. Half inning complete for Bethune-Cookman. Hector Vasquez on the mound. Bottom one coming up. Final game here on this Friday on the SWAC Digital Network.
Building champions for life didn't just happen overnight. Since 1920, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, SWAC, has been in the forefront in leadership and excellence in all our athletic programs. There are very few major sports halls of fame that a SWAC athlete is not a member. Hall of Fame coaches who were stewards and mentors to these elite athletes, our tradition, our distinction, our legacy. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
Back here at Birmingham downtown. You got the UAB medical facilities here downtown. And the home of Regions Field here in Birmingham, Alabama. We had rain here to start. Conference did a heck of a job in kind of dodging the weather as best as they could, moving a couple of games around. Two games today played over at UAB, two elimination games. We'll still have games tomorrow. And that's the good thing, Coach, about Saturday. That's what Saturday's built for. As you look at Grambling's lineup, brought to you by Chevy. And look, Coach, look at number two.
That makes you really happy.
Well, I don't know if you believe that Shamar Page was going to be in the lineup. There it is,
yes.
Brought to you by Chevy. Shamar Page playing left field here in this final game on this Friday night.
Where's Shamar Page from?
He's from Laurel, Mississippi.
Oh, okay. He's a tough Mississippi boy.
He's from the Magnolia State. And it's almost a guarantee. You can bet the house, the farm, the condo, that tomorrow if Grambling makes it, you're going to see Shamar Page all over the lineup, whether on the mound, in the field, whatever it takes, if Grambling gets to tomorrow. But for them to get to tomorrow, they have to do what? They have to win tonight.
Yeah. And it's, you know, the way the pitcher started out for Grambling gives them encouragement. There is encouragement there.
Well, Jar Parker at the plate for Grambling. Parker just 250 in this postseason. His ninth at bat, two hits. He has scored four runs. Swing and a miss here. Count is 1-1. We're underway here in the bottom of the first inning. Bethune-Cookman went down in order. Grambling coming up as the 1-1 misses. Hector Vasquez on the mound. Vasquez during the season 6-5 with a 4.15 earned run average. 13 starts during the regular season. Fly ball down the right side. Is there a play under these bright lights? No. At first.
The stars second. Come out in under the bright lights.
Yeah. And that time the stars from Bethune-Cookman on the right side of that defense could not make the play. Part for the Wildcats. The count is 1-2 to the leadoff man, Parker. The end of the bat, fair ball down the first baseline, bobbled there, but recovered and stepped on the bag, one away. As Boris Pena with the three unassisted, if you're scoring at home. It's a good play right here, Coach. I mean, the little squibber.
Squibbler or tough.
It could have hit the bag.
Yeah.
That might have distracted him just enough, thinking it might have, but he stayed with it despite the bobble and steps on the bag. And now, Coach, here's your man, Shamar Page.
And he swings from the left side.
Page.
Dangerous for his right arm.
This is his fifth at bat in the tournament. He has a home run and four runs batted in. That must have been over. That must have been over at UAB when he did that. So he actually leads the team in batting average in the postseason, hitting 750.
You know, pitchers are usually your better athlete historically.
How interesting is it? He throws righty, but he bats lefty.
Yeah, it's not good because the right arm is exposed.
Here's the pitch. This is outside, obviously. Bethune Cookman is aware, I think, of what Page can do at the plate. So obviously Vasquez trying to stay away from Page as much as possible. Here's a 2-0. Strike call on the outside corner. I mean, we're talking with Coach Pierre. He believes the Golden Spikes Award, Coach.
He what?
The Golden Spikes Award.
What about it?
He was talking about possibility, you know, Page
being a nominee.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
He could be a nominee for that. He feels like he has a really good shot, you know, at least getting his name in the hopper.
Mm-hmm.
3-1. What do you think about, you know, about those awards?
Well, I don't know his numbers. I mean, I don't know his season or numbers.
We can definitely pull it up.
Well, when we can, we'll let you know, and I'll be frank with you.
Here's the 3-1, and this is sliced down the left side in foul territory. Is there a play? Yes, sir. Two out. Down the left side, Stevens.
He's got a 242 average in 111 at-bats. Nothing spectacular. No, it's not. He can put his name in, but he doesn't have nothing that would jump out at people who are going to vote who don't know him. You got me?
Garcia stands in for Grambling. So it's safe to say, and you would know, you got to probably hit 320, 330.
Oh, no, you better hit 400, close to
400.
Oh, 450. Oh,
my goodness.
You better hit. Oh, no, you got to.
370, and you weren't even in
the
conversation?
No, 370 ain't going to do it.
Whoa, here's a shot to second, inning over. So both sides with a 1-2-3 in the first inning. We go to the second, scoreless final game of the night here from Birmingham on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Back here in Birmingham, final game of this day three. It will be tomorrow at 9, Southern and FAMU at 9, and then at 12, it'll be Bama State versus the winner of this game. Here's Bethune-Cookman's lineup, brought to you by Chevy. Stevens with Garcia and Patterson. You see the rest. Good lineup, quality at-bats. It was back and forth between Bethune and Bama State, but Bama State pulled away late. Ground ball to second, and already we're one away.
That's always good. He's throwing strikes.
Yeah, strikeout and three straight ground balls. Let's get back to this Golden Spikes Award, Coach, because you very much were familiar with that. We're talking during the break. Ricky Weeks hit almost 400.
No, almost 500.
Almost 500, excuse me. He hit almost 500. That is unbelievable. And in today's baseball, you're talking about you got to hit at least 400, you think, to even?
Well, they got people who are close to that with big numbers with home runs and RBIs. I'm thinking about the guy Tennessee. I'm thinking about Melendez at University of Texas. Those two guys, I'm not talking about no one else because I don't know.
Yeah.
You got Crew at LSU. He got 20-some home runs in the SEC. I mean, those guys, you see, when you start putting your numbers, they're going to say they're putting number up against legitimate top-flight pro prospect.
Yes.
You see, so that's where it came. And when it came with Ricky Weeks was obviously the best college player. And they were trying to talk him down because he played in the SWAC.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's where I came in.
You were head coach / politician of trying to lobby. And you were telling me during the break you were on the phone every morning trying to make some calls.
Made
the calls. You made calls. And so you were lobbying for it for 4 weeks.
Well, you had to call the people who were difference makers. Once I found out who the difference makers were, I had to sell them.
Here's a ground ball to short. This could be 2-6-4-3, double play. So the defense, a walk, a double play, and nobody left as we take a look at it here. Man, we've seen a lot of good DPs here. That's the pitcher's best friend, tailor-made. That's
but
what they call it.
He's throwing ground balls. He's forcing them to hit it on the ground, which is always a good thing.
A walk, a double play, nobody stranded. Already we're an inning and a half in. Scoreless. 4, 5, and 6 coming up. Hatton, Buford, Mack for the G-Men. After this on the SWAC Digital Network.
Building champions for life didn't just happen overnight. Since 1920, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, SWAC, has been in the forefront in leadership and excellence in all our athletic programs. There are very few major sports halls of fame that a SWAC athlete is not a member. Hall of Fame coaches who were stewards and mentors to these elite athletes, our tradition, our distinction, our legacy. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
Trevor Hatton leading off for the G-Men, the right fielder facing Vasquez. Bottom two underway. Inside, ball one. Hatton hitting 250 in this postseason, ninth at bat, an RBI. couple of hits. The loser of this game is eliminated. The winner will take on Bama State tomorrow at 12 o'clock. And it'll be Bama State and obviously Southern University. Those two teams have yet to lose.
And they were the first, they were the top seed on each side.
Yeah.
Which they're proven out to be true to form.
Yeah, you are exactly right. And, you know, I've always thought the SWAC baseball tournament was the ultimate unknown. Anywhere from a 1 to a 4, or 4 to a 1 could win it. And right now, the one seed in the West is in, and the one seed in the East is in. The question is, in the semifinals. We'll try
okay,
to get
don't say they're in. I don't want you to say that. Somebody's out there listening. Say Southern is in the final.
No,
they got to win a game tomorrow.
They got to win a game tomorrow, correct. That, you know, they're in the, that bracket final, and a win by the Jaguars, they'll be in the championship round. Off the end of the bat, one hopper to second, and one away.
This is good pitching. Nobody's overpowering. They're forcing the players to swing the bat, and they're keeping the ball down in the zone, which creates a lot of ground ball. This was where he was. See, you can't hit that way. He was pulling his body out, and he's swinging with his arm only. You got me?
Yeah.
And that's not the way you want to hit.
Well, it'll bring up Cameron Buford, the shortstop. It's just high, ball one. Buford, 375 in the postseason, three hits. A run scored, three runs batted in for Buford. Fouled it straight back. You know, these postseason awards, Coach, in today's collegiate baseball, I mean, you talked about what you had to do, the lobbying you had to do, the phone calls you had to do. Even we're talking in between how even with someone like Weeks, his next pitch, strike called, you were sending box scores to the voters after every game?
Every game. That's the way you do it. The people needed to know about him up in the Northeast and on the East Coast and the Midwest and the South, and the West, West Coast. That's the only way they would know about him, to get something every day. And then when the voting time came, he got the votes.
Yeah, yeah.
Remember, I thought about when Walter Payton and Doug Williams were up for the Heisman Trophy, and they got very little votes. You got me? I don't know what they did, but I'm telling you what I did.
Yeah.
I know what I did. I don't know what Eddie Robinson did. But I got on that phone every day at 8 o'clock. I'm talking to people on the East Coast.
Yeah.
It's 9 o'clock over there.
Yeah.
I'm talking to them.
Yeah. So a sales job for sure. And the numbers, you know, spoke for themselves, but you had to do that extra push, that extra lobbying.
Well, because they were using the old racist attitude that he played in the black conference, and that we were inferior. That's what they were trying to say. And I wouldn't let him get away with it. I refused to let him get away with it.
Well, a strikeout here by Buford, it'll bring up Elon Mack, the DH. Mack hitting 444 in this postseason, 10th at bat, three runs batted in. So the first five set down by Vasquez. This is high, ball one. We started with eight. Three teams were eliminated today. The loser of this game is eliminated. Jackson State eliminated. Texas Southern eliminated. FAMU eliminated. Prairie View 17-1 in the game prior to this one. Coach Kador Centoria Black brought that game in, and I was absolutely astounded by the score of that game. I thought it was going to be 17-13, to be honest, because you talked about the pitching. I thought it would be one of those games. But I tell you what, FAMU, you know, obviously jumped on Prairie View, never looked back.
And they had a pitcher named Fox who just did an outstanding job. He threw a lot of strikes and just didn't let him off the hook.
Yeah.
He got him on the hook and he wouldn't let him off. Sort of like when you're fishing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about me and fishing, Coach. Let's stay away from that one. I have fishing stories, but it's horror stories. It's pitch swing and a miss. Side is retired. So, this pitcher Vasquez, back-to-back Ks, and he has set down the first six, and we have played a couple. we have a scoreless game. When we come back for Bethune Cookman, we'll take it up here in the next inning. And for Bethune Cookman in the third, Garcia, Reyes, and Allison, 7-8-9 coming up on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country, and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Cricket is keeping you connected to the things that matter most with the best deals, smile-worthy plans, and a reliable nationwide network. Visit your local Cricket store today. We are in the top of the third inning. Moving right along, good pitching matchup here. Connor versus Vasquez. Scoreless top three. The number seven hitter, Jeremy Garcia, the third baseman at the plate for the Wildcats. This pitch misses outside. Jeremy Garcia just 1-11 in the postseason. 10th at bat with a run batted in.
And you see, Charles, you see how easy the game becomes when pitchers throw strikes?
Mm-hmm.
The games become a struggle when they're always behind and your defense is not going to be as good. So when the pitcher throws strike, he forces the hitters to swing the bat. Now they're putting the ball in play. Your defense can be a participant, and they make everything easy for him.
Yeah, so far it's been easy for these pitchers so far in this one.
Now, it's going to get a little more difficult when the second round come around because that's usually the case. They get a better understanding what the pitcher is doing to them in the second time up.
Well, strike out here. As Garcia goes down swinging on an inside pitch, it'll bring up Jan Reyes, the center fielder. Reyes, no average, seventh at bat with one run batted in for the Wildcats. Talking about postseason stats, I always like to give those postseason numbers, Coach, because regular season is one thing, but you always talk about what you do in the postseason.
Postseason is critical. And the thing is that, the big thing going in Grambling has going in his favor is that Cookman is not a big offensive team. They don't put up a lot of numbers. So if they could keep them down two, three, four runs, Grambling got a chance.
Oh, this pitch he was hit. Inside pitch. And Reyes couldn't.
Of all the people he hit the guy with no average.
That is absolutely true. Reyes, no average coming in. And he just got hit. So that's the number eight hitter. We've seen those little idiosyncrasies, Coach, how, throwing air opens the gates. We've seen that earlier today.
Yeah.
So now you hit a guy, number eight hitter, with no average.
Eight hole hitter. The last guy you want in.
Allison, he has no average. This is his eighth at bat, his pitch strike call. So we'll see what happens here.
Yeah.
You got the bottom of the lineup, the number nine hitter, Colton Allison, at the plate for the Wildcats. One on, one out. This pitcher, Connor, has walked one, has struck out a couple. He's hit one. How unnerving, Coach, is a pitcher when he hits a guy? I mean, if good pitchers just let it roll off their back?
Yeah. I mean, that's part of the game. Remember, it's a game of failure. it's failure for pitchers too as well as hitters. Okay.
Here's a chopper to third. Uh-oh, third couldn't scoop it. It's going to be a base hit. Two on for Bethune-Cookman. So the HBP and the single by Allison, the bottom of the lineup.
There you go. This is what happens. Man.
Let's see, let's look at that one here and see. Is that just mechanics here? Coach, third baseman didn't get down on it?
I think he backed up some. Let's see if I could. He backed up. And he overlaid. And you could have gone across the way he did, but you got to be able to still try to get it in front of you so he can shadow step the ball to second base.
That's 2-1 in the top of the lineup. Well, it's a wild pitch, and it's going to be second and third.
This is what happens. This is a beautiful game. It punishes you when you don't do things right, and it rewards you when you do them wrong. Right. You got me?
Well, the number 8 hitter, Reyes, with no average, he was hit. Then Allison with no average, he singled. Now wild pitch in his second and third.
If you tell me number 9 had no average, then we got something.
It's ground ball to short. Well, Grambling will concede the run. The throw across close, but out. Good hustle by Stevens. But Reyes scores. Allison stays at second, 1-0 with Bethune-Cookman. Let's take a look at this here. Ground ball to second, to short. Obviously, Coach, you see the short looking home. There's no way he could have got the runner at home.
Well, I'm not going to say no way, but you don't want to take that chance.
Yeah.
You want to get it out because you were playing to get it out. You were not playing to cut the run off.
Do you think he would have had a play at home?
Well, I don't know. I would have to be able to see it in its totality because I didn't like the way the run on third base came off. See, when you're going on contact, you ain't looking to see how he's going to catch it. Soon the ball is hit on the ground, you're going. He was trying to look at how the guy caught the ball. You got me?
Uh-huh.
And that's not how you do when you go in contact. It's exactly what you say. Contact, you go, whether you hit a line drive or not, you're gone. It's a suicide sort of situation. You got me?
Yeah. So you just go. Don't look back. Here's a chopper too short on two hops. Low hop and the throw is there. And the side is retired as Buford's been busy. But the bottom of the lineup, two players with no average in this postseason. Reyes, no average. He was hit. Allison, no average. He singled. A wild pitch mixed in there. And the Wildcats have the lead. A run on one hit, a batter hit, a wild pitch, and one stranded. We have played 2.5 here in Birmingham. 7-8-9 coming up for Grambling. After this, timeout on the SWAC Digital Network.
Building champions for life didn't just happen overnight. Since 1920, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, SWAC, has been in the forefront in leadership and excellence in all our athletic programs. There are very few major sports halls of fame that a SWAC athlete is not a member. Hall of Fame coaches who were stewards and mentors to these elite athletes, our tradition, our distinction, our legacy. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
Hope everyone has a good and safe Memorial Day holiday. Typically, the SWAC baseball tournament has been right after the SWAC softball tournament, back-to-back softball baseball, but due to the addition, Coach Cador, of FAMU and Bethune-Cookman, the baseball season is just a little bit longer. Therefore, the baseball tournament is a couple weeks later, and that's why we're here at this point with the holiday coming up. Aries Gardner standing in for Grambling, down 1-0. Pitch from Vasquez. Up and in. Ayers Gardner, 143 during this postseason. One hit, his eighth at bat, Coach Kador.
That's okay. He looks good in there. Let's see what he does.
Oh, this is a slicer.
He got the ball, let the ball get by him a little.
He was jammed. Still was able to power it towards left.
And jam is exactly what it was.
As Stevens hauls it in, one away. And that is now 7 straight set down by Vasquez. It'll bring up David Valoy Jr. for the Tigers. Valoy, no average, 10th at bat.
Ooh,
Valoy, a shot to left, and it's going to be all the way to the wall. Extra bases for Valoy, makes the turn, and he gets in there. A double for Grambling, first base runner, first base hit for the G-men.
Don't make sense. Why would he jump and not put his glove up? He might have caught the ball. This is some of the things I
can't. All right, you take a look at it.
Watch. Don't jump and not put the glove up. Look. He could have caught it. Boy, I tell you, you know, not a lot of people, they don't understand.
The technicalities of baseball, Coach, you are, I think that's the reason why you won so many championships. In large part, talent, of course, but just the technicalities of the game that I'm learning from you, in addition to the talent, the two T's, the technicalities and the talent, I see why you were so successful.
That's right. I demand that they do the technicality right, because that's what wins when you don't have the great talent. You got me? Guys know I was on them about the smallest thing.
And that's why you're practicing. Well, with the smallest stuff that you were on them, but you said the other day that your practices were only 45 minutes long. To an hour. 45 minutes to an hour. So with all that, the technicalities, you would think that would take up a lot of time, but I guess – their players figured it out to where you might not have had to go over quite as much as the season wore on, and they understood what was expected.
Exactly. Well, and the thing, the way we did it, the field practice was 45 to an hour. Then kids venture off into the batting cage and worked on their own for the most part, you got me?
Yeah.
But on the field, and then because when we finished that, we spent time with the pitchers, if we had to work on something with a pitcher in the bullpen,
yeah,
we gave them that special time. You got me?
Yeah.
So we gave the body, the whole body, 45 minutes to an hour, and then we broke off into special groups. You
okay.
Got me?
So it was a little longer than that, obviously. Just as a team, you went
but
back.
But as a team.
There's a wild pitch here, runner to third. So Beloy doubled in a wild pitch, and he's at third.
As a team, when I'm there being the general looking at them, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, when them guys hit in and when the pitchers are pitching, I'm only there looking, giving them special instruction.
Talking with different coaches, and you know, they always preach this, you know, you just can't get it done during the practice session. You got to take the extra cuts in the cage before practice. After practice, like in basketball, you put up 1,000 shots before practice, 1,000 shots after practice, 1,000 free throws, whatever it may be. Were players back in the day putting in that extra time, whether it's on the mound, in the cage,
feeling ground ball?
Was it a lot of that in the league back then throughout?
I don't know about the league. I can only speak about us. We did that,
mm-hmm.
And I had good assistant coaches that understood. Hey, I didn't always have to tell them what to go work on with someone. They recognize, hey, Ricky Weeks need another 200 ground balls, okay?
200.
Oh, yeah, you got – that's the only way you're going to get better.
200 ground balls.
Oh, no, you got to do it because you're not going to get better unless you do it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
That's a lot of – I mean, you know why he's as good as he was, but 200 ground balls, man, that's a lot. That's work.
That's work. But what we did now, we didn't have him throwing it. We had him feel him and put him in the bucket.
Yeah.
So you don't wear yourself out throwing. And the instruction was don't run him all over the place. Hit a lot of them balls right after him, at him, so he can learn to feel those. You got me?
There's the pitch swaying at a miss, and down goes Frederick.
Yeah.
Frederick, no average.
That's okay. It'll get better.
So through the first nine in the lineup here, Vasquez has struck out three. He's given up just one hit. And a runner at third, two out for the top of the lineup, Jar Parker. Under the first his last time up, so good chance for Grambling here, runner at third. Well, this is what Grambling's looking for, getting the leadoff man at the plate with a runner in scoring position here. 1-0, Wildcats, a chance for Grambling. Strike call. You know, I see a lot of coaches. I see Mike Robb of Texas Southern, very meticulous in terms of working out his team before game.
Yes.
And standing behind the cage, you know, on the top platform there watching – you know, the techniques. Were you into that? You know, as far as standing behind home plate, watching your players take cuts.
I did it sometime, but I let my assistant coaches do a lot of that. It was something I wanted to mention, Charles, and it slipped my mind. I know we spoke a little the other day about, you know, if you work kids too long over and over things and they don't get it right.
There's a fly ball here, shallow center, and it's going to be caught, and the side is retired. Well, the Tigers had a heck of an opportunity right there as Ray has hauled it in. A one-out double by Valoy. He's stranded at third. So we have gone through the third inning. Our score, 1-0 Wildcats. We'll take this time out, and when we come back, we'll have Patterson, Escobar, and Perez coming up after this on the SWAC Digital Network.
In 1920, an athletic league was formed and slowly became one of the leading sports associations in the world of collegiate athletics, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for student athletes and promoting academic excellence. Each SWAC member institution represents a high level of integrity and sportsmanship. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
Welcome back to Birmingham. A pitch swing and a miss, and we are underway. Christopher Patterson stands in for the Wildcats. 3, 4, and 5 coming up.
This game is taking the kind of situation where it may be the middle of the game before somebody figures out what they need to do.
Connor hanging in. This pitch is inside. Well, Coach, what do you think about, you know, today's baseball player versus when you were playing in terms of, and I know you've been around the game, the collegiate level, in terms of just trying to get guys to that next level, just the work ethic, the work habit. You know, you talked about Ricky Weeks taking 200 ground balls. Is that something that you see in your travels in collegiate baseball today?
I see when I go out of the country a lot more than I do in the country, okay?
Wow.
You'll see more kids hitting here in the state than you do. But, you know, when I go out the country, I see it, especially in Puerto Rico, they really feel ball. They do a lot of things. I wanted to say something about Chris Crenshaw.
Fouled it straight back.
I've observed his practice. Chris is going to be somebody to the conference is going to have to be able to deal with, because he does his practice the right way. And the way he practices, players can't do nothing but get better. They'll be game prepared. You got me? Mm-hmm. And so I told him, I said, Chris, don't ever change anything you're doing. I said, if you keep your players doing that, you will keep developing good players for years to come. The only missing component, you're going to have to go get you some pitching that can, you know. So those are the kind of things. If you put kids in good, healthy environment where they can get better, they'll pay a dividend for you for a long time. So I wanted to throw that in because his practice was way better than my practice.
Really?
And I had to tell him that, yeah. Well, I mean, I'm not selfish. I'm not, you know. I said, man, your practice is as good as it gets, you know.
And you know the meticulous time that it takes in practice. So for you to say that about any coach, I mean, considering how important practice is.
Yeah, it is important. And he's got it going, man. It's good. I try to tell all the people, I said, man, this guy got this thing. He's got a really good practice.
Well, Southern University will be on display first tomorrow at 9 a.m. against FAMU. Southern's had to battle back twice. There's a base hit off the bat of Patterson. So leadoff is on here for the Wildcats.
You see Patterson turn his back, put down the ball. You know, I'm saying he can't go to second on it. But there's a reason you don't want to turn your back on the ball, know where the ball is. Because if the game is tight and that happens, things can happen. You got me?
Yeah.
So that's all.
That was hit with a lot of depth too, Coach.
Look, you see, look, he's turned his head away from the ball. Look, you see what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
I would be yelling from over there, watch the ball, know where the ball is.
Here's a bunt here, Escobar, pitcher to short one, and it's a 1-6 fielder's choice. A little double clutch there at short. Buford may have had a shot at a double
play.
Well,
he maybe was he maybe had it. I thought the first baseman had come up. He had it, a shot.
Right there, and then that hesitation.
Well, he had to grip the ball.
Yeah.
He was trying to grip it properly.
Fielder's choice, so Escobar at first. It'll bring up Perez. Pitch misses outside. So with all the opportunities, Coach, you know, you talk about the MLB Urban Invitational. You know, that's a really good tournament in February in which, you know, got scouts there, the Andre Dawson Classic. You happy with the opportunity? You know, we talk about, we just had the NFL draft and the opportunities. You know, you had four players get drafted. Uh-huh. Are you happy with what baseball is doing in terms of getting players to that next level?
We're about to do something much, much better. I can't talk about it because it hadn't been published yet, but we're about to next year going to do a lot more to help players from historical black schools with MLB.
Yeah.
So we're going to do something really special for them. So
I was told of a meeting in Atlanta in which there's some initiatives that came out of that meeting.
Yeah, but that's a whole different thing.
A whole nother ball of wax.
I'm dealing with the commissioner's office, you know.
Check swing here, and he did go around.
Yeah.
So down goes Perez. A little check swing. Let's take a look at it here. Did he go around? You be the judge at home. Across the plane? Let's see.
He did. Oh.
Ooh.
He did a good job.
Yeah, that's one.
Nobody's perfect.
Two-out runner at first. The first baseman, Boris Pena, at the plate. Pitch from Connor. Old ball one. Well, Grambling had a chance in the last half inning. They had a one-out double by Valoy, stranded at third. Wildcats with a 1-0 lead. A ground ball RBI by Stevens. The two batters in the lineup at the bottom with no average. Reyes was hit. Allison singled. Wild pitch. Make it second and third, and then the ground ball brought the It's by Stevens, brought home Reyes. 1-0 Wildcats on two hits.
Oh, it's so funny. No average.
Pitch from Connor.
No average, and he scored. It's one of us scored a run.
That's what makes baseball so wonderfully funny and strange game.
You see, you got to put the ball in the baskets with free throw something to get a point in basketball.
Yeah, you sure do.
Yeah, guy, no average, and he scored.
Ground ball off his foot. Caroms out to third.
Yeah.
No plate umpire definitely was on the call there.
Guy with no average score run. Isn't that beautiful? Well, let's see. Did the ball hit him on the foot here? Let's see. Hit him on the foot.
Yeah.
I thought it did it. Oh, okay. That's, well, they didn't go nowhere. Yeah.
Here's the pitch, just missed, and Connor thought he had him.
Well, the catcher was pulling it. That tells me it was outside because the catcher tried to pull it, and he's telling the coach it was outside.
Yeah, you see it right there.
Yeah, he's outside.
You see his arm waving outside.
Yeah.
Count is full, 3-2. Escobar will be taking off from here. There's a shot in the left, and this ball is going to go off the wall here.
Oh, this could be trouble.
Escobar around third. He motors in, and a double. And the Wildcats lead 2-0.
This baseball is also a game of inches. It shows up so many times that it's a game of inches. Why am I saying that? He missed the ball off the plate by a couple of inches from getting the strike, right?
Yeah.
Look, you see, because he would have had three strikes. And then he missed over the plate and a few inches over the left fielder's head. Well, more than inches, but the point I'm making, though, it's a game of inches because he missed a couple of inches outside for strike three.
Yeah. It definitely was close. And even the catcher acknowledged that
it was outside.
It was outside. So now the Wildcats have a lead here, 2-0. They just got a run on two hits in this inning. So they're up 2-0.
And the other thing that was critical, it became a full count in the run at first base. Escobar took off running because it was full count with two outs.
Yeah.
Normally he wouldn't score on that.
The left fielder gave it up. He knew that was over his head. There's a ground ball in the hole, and that's a base hit. Pena around third. Here comes the throw. It's going to be cut off. Wildcats with a 3-0 lead. Garcia's RBI single scores Pena, who doubled. And it's 3-0.
With two outs. Little did I know, I said around the fifth inning, something might break. It broke before then.
So 3-0 in RBI.
But 3-0 is not out of whack. It's still within reach. And Grambling still can. Another hit.
He has a base hit down the left side this May. And it will not score a run, but a double at second and third. So Bethune Cookman getting to Connor here. Time called. Want to take a quick break right here. Bethune-Cookman has runners on at second and third. Two out. They're up 3-0. We'll be back after this on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Academically, competitively, and athletically to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
All right, welcome back. It's 3-0 here, Coach. And what is Bethune Cookman doing here? What's going on with this pitcher, Connor?
Connor is, well, I did mention that earlier that the second time in the lineup, they may be able to figure him out a little better. And we'll run that, you know, that area where they had the second time in the lineup. And because he doesn't have great stuff, but he was throwing enough pitches down in the zone, forcing them to hit ground ball. Then he started elevating them, and they got much better swing.
Four hits in this inning. And an error. Off of third, recovers in the throw. It's too late, and a run is in.
Two errors over there. Well, they gave one of them
Look
a hit.
Look at this, a hot this shot.
He got in between hop. He should have came and got the big hop. Got to give it to the credit to that runner, number two. He was getting down the line.
A run is in, and it's 4-0. Three runs, four hits, and an error. And top of the lineup here for the Wildcats.
It was the bottom of the lineup.
Absolutely. The bottom of the lineup has been dangerous here. So you look at the last three, Garcia, Reyes, and Allison. Garcia with an RBI. Reyes hit and doubled. And Allison singled and an error right there. So the bottom three has been on base five times.
Five times.
Bottom three in the lineup.
Most of two of them no average.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Top of the lineup here for the Wildcats. They're 4-0. Loser of this game is eliminated. The winner of this game will play Bama State tomorrow at noon. Connor at the belt brings it home to short.
Oh, get rid of it.
Throw to second. Side is a retired, but beginning for the Wildcats, three runs, four hits, an error, one stranded. We'll take a break here. Grambling down 4-0 as we go to the bottom of the fourth inning. And when we come back, it will be Paige, Garcia, and Hatton coming up on the SWAC Digital Network. What's important is that you can hear me, son. Okay. Gatorade is a proud supporter of the SWAC Conference. When you give everything, Gatorade gives it back. Life is a sport. Drink it up. Gatorade is a proud supporter of the Southwestern Athletic Conference. 4-0, Bethune-Cookman. Grambling needs to get to work here in the bottom of the fourth inning. It'll be Shamar Page, who flied to right his last time up. Then John Garcia, then Trevor Hatton. Squaring the butt is Page. Ball's outside. Ball one.
That was a smart thing what he was trying to do. Get something started. Third base is back. Not a bad idea.
Now the Grambling bullpen is going to start to get busy. Is Grambling trying to stay alive? This pitch misses.
Remember, he was throwing plenty of strike. You get four runs now. What do you do? You can't play around, start throwing bows.
Grambling lost to this Bethune team 4-3. Page got the start. A 3-run home run was the difference. Grambling hung in. Page hung in. Then Grambling eliminated Texas Southern 14-5.
There's
a slicer in the left center. This ball is going to drop for a base hit. Long single by Page. No, he's going to get to second, and he's there with a double to lead it off for the J-Man.
He don't play like a pitcher. I mean, he's not bad.
And Page got some speed, too.
Yeah, Page is not bad. Let's see how he run the bag. Well, we're not going to see that. Let's see, maybe.
So a double for Page, leading it off for the G-men. John Garcia stands in. Garcia, the catcher, fly to second his last time up. Pitch from Vasquez, time called. Time called before the pitch. Well, Grambling was in a situation last year trying to fight out of the hole. They lost to Jackson State in the bracket semifinal. Previous game, they played Jackson State. They're down 14-1. Came back and tied the game up. Lost 15-14. Then lost to Jackson State.
I remembered it.
So this Grambling team can battle.
Oh, no, they got a lot of fight in them. Tiger don't have more than one life. May not have nine, but it's got more than one.
This Grambling team second in the league in average behind Texas Southern, so they can find a way to get on base. They're going to have to get something going here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Five hits for the Wildcats, two for Grambling. Bullpen busy for GSU. Just trying to hang on and hang in, stay alive. Vasquez brings it home. It's a fly ball in the center, and it's going to be caught. And Page has to stay right where he is, one away. Reyes hauls it in. One down. It'll bring up the right fielder, Trevor Hatton.
Hit that ball pretty good right there. Just hit it right at him. You needed a wheelie keeler. Hit him where they ain't.
Of course, for Grambling, trying to stay alive, their head coach is Davin Pierre. He's interim head coach. We'll see what happens at the end of the season. Dr. Travian Scott, newly hired athletic director, will he make Davin Pierre permanent head baseball coach? There's the pitch, check swing, went
is
around.
Is there any reason they shouldn't hire him permanent?
I mean, you look at what Grambling has done. Of course, previous coach James Cooper took a job with the Yankees organization down in Tampa.
I know you Grambling guys are tough hire. You guys are tough.
Swing and a miss here.
No, maybe. Okay. Maybe we're saying that was not a foul tip.
I mean, just yeah. Looking at how Grambling has battled. We're in the race to win the West. Will Pierre get the job permanently? We'll find out as we get into the offseason.
Time will tell.
Yeah, time will tell. I've always been interested, Coach, at the baseball calendar. When baseball season ends in May, and I guess I'm assuming baseball is like every other sport, there is really no off season. There is no downtime. How long before when the season ends in May or June after the regionals before you get right back at it? Is it really just no stoppage?
Well, when you say stoppage, I need to know what you
stoppage in terms of just things kind of come to a halt, just kind of take a deep breath, assess – and then kind of get back at it for recruiting and then just kind of build it through the summer. Then you got fall ball in the fall. Is there any downtime in collegiate baseball?
Not like it used to. When I was early in my coaching career, we did. But now there's no downtime.
So like every other sport, there is no off season.
There's no off season. Recruiting is so demanding, you know.
Yeah.
Now there's a dead period taking place now in baseball. There is a dead period right now. So,
yeah.
But, you know, recruiting is everything, man. You know.
Hatton trying to put Grambling on the board. Pitch from Vasquez. Trying to poke it down the right side. Foul. And now a collegiate baseball coach, it's been, what, maybe 2 or 3 years, you can kind of pinpoint the time frame where you can now play games in the fall.
Yeah.
You can play games, whereas when you were coaching, that wasn't the case. You can actually play some games in the fall against other teams in the fall.
Well, we could play in the fall when I first started.
Uh-huh.
They would not count toward your season, you know?
Right.
You just play them.
But how important is that to get that live action in the fall as you get ready for the spring?
Well, you can find out more about exactly where you are, what you need to improve on. So it gives you a good
measuring stick?
Measuring stick, yeah.
Cameron Buford at the plate struck out his last time up.
See, they hadn't taken good swings when your man led off with a double.
You think Grambling has kind of figured out Vasquez a little bit? You think it's banished Vasquez still?
They hadn't figured it out yet. See, Page has. You know, but Garcia and Ahada.
Grambling with two hits, both extra base hits. Page with a double and Valoy with a double. Ground ball to short. Inning over. Grambling gets a leadoff double by Page, and he is stranded at second. We'll take a break right here as Bethune-Cookman will come up in the fifth inning. Three-run fourth. They're up 4-0 here on the G-Men. The loser is eliminated. The winner will take on Bama State tomorrow at noon. Fifth inning coming up after this here on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Visit the official tournament central page, SWAC.org. You can access game previews, photo galleries, team rosters, stats, live stats, links, and more. Go to SWAC.org for more information. Boy, that website has been bustling to start at the tournament with all the delays and starts and stops and movement of games. The SWAC office has been really busy, over the championships, having to move the pieces around, moved a couple of games over to UAB. Couldn't quite get totally caught up, but that's what Saturday is for. That's built in. There's a shot in the left center, a base hit. Off the bat of Garcia. And now you look at Bethune-Cookman coach, 6 hits off of Connor. The bullpen was busy for Grambling. How long, if you're Coach Pierre, you're down 4-0, an elimination game, how long do you stick with Connor here?
You really can't stick too much longer. you're about midway through during the game, you know. So you need to, and you hadn't been able to do much offensively. So you got to try and hold them and hope you can get strike with lightning in the bottle, you know, because all it takes is get a couple run on and somebody miss over the plate.
Well, Patterson swinging here, swinging a miss. He's one for two, grounded to second and singled. Four runs, six hits, no errors for the Wildcats. 0-2-1 for Grambling. It'll be FAMU and Southern tomorrow morning at 9. Boy, FAMU, they ended preview season, and I didn't see that score coming, Coach. You were here to be a part of that one. Obviously, pitching, or lack thereof, tough to see preview season come to an end like that.
Yeah, like that, yeah. You know, I'm surprised he's not bunting here, because we talk about getting that fifth run where Grand Slam can't tie you.
Yeah.
This would be a time for you to try and bunt him over. So, you know, I mean, those things means a lot in baseball, because we've seen where teams were up 4-0 and they almost lost it.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah.
Teams were up 7 runs.
And
they lost it.
Yeah,
yes.
So you got to keep trying to get runs.
Runner going here, double clutch, and the throw, and it's too late. Stolen base for Garcia. Here comes Davin Pierre. We might get a challenge here. He's pointing. Is he going to get a challenge? He wants a challenge. See, the umpires are going to huddle up. And as the protocol here, they'll huddle up first, talk about it, and then they'll look at it. Haven't seen a case where they've huddled up and did not look at it. All right, so let's take a look here.
Oh, my. Let's see.
That was a strong throw, too.
This catcher can throw from Grambling. I'm surprised.
The throw beat him.
Oh, he's on that bag. On the bag. On the bag.
From that angle.
That's the best angle we've got.
Yeah, from that angle, it looks like he got there by a fingernail. I said it a couple of games ago.
It looked like a fingernail.
Yeah, I think that's a true fingernail situation. They're going to look at it. But that's bang. That's really bang, bang right here.
See, if he slides a little later, it's not going to be as close. See, yeah, that fingernail.
Based on what we're seeing, again, the umpires are reviewing this just as you are.
And they need more evidence to overthrow.
Yeah.
Or overrule, rather.
Yeah, the ruling is safe, so there has to be something there to overturn this. They're freezing it right there, so I'm sure they'll probably wind it back again. James Crenshaw, producer. I just want to take another look, a deeper dive into this one. From what we can see here, it looks like Garcia just got in there. Frame by frame, right?
Yeah, he's in. He ain't touching it yet. There you go.
Yeah, right there.
Yeah.
Great camera work on the camera. Dez Rogers, Lauren Sutton, Roosevelt Smith. And that's a clear view.
Well, they only, believe, but those people had to be hired by someone, the producer.
And believe it or not, they're really, really young in college.
Yeah, that's good. I like that, though.
Getting the experience and giving us great shots. And this shot, to us, shows that the call will stand. And it does.
Yes, it does. I mean, they didn't have anything to overturn it.
Yeah, if you're Davin Pierre, you had to take a shot. I mean, your team's down.
We haven't charge given Mr. Crenshaw a lot of credit for the great job he's doing producing this event.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been around a lot of sporting events, and I'm impressed with what is taking place here.
And
a young African American man who is hiring young African American people, training them. And really doing a good job, so I just want to give him a shout-out.
Putting on a good product for fans to see online. And, of course, you have a talk show, Coach, that you have down in Baton Rouge. And so you know all about this stuff and what it takes to produce a show.
Yeah, I do. And, you know, I don't really get involved in the production end of it. I just go do just go and do the show.
Yeah.
They get when I get there, they just turn the lights on, camera, let's go.
Is it sports only, or is it just whatever the issues of the day? Is a swing and a miss?
It's a sports, but mostly football. It's mostly football because football is so big.
Yeah.
I do it from September to March. I don't want to do it the whole year. You know, I just do September to March. And we do because it's easy for advertising because the football is so big in the area.
It definitely is. Yeah. A lot to talk about.
And it's a lot to talk about.
Yeah, down
we talk back. About Southern, LSU, and the Saints.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there in all three. Saints have a new coach. LSU has a new coach. Right. Southern has a new coach.
Right.
So there's never a shortage of stuff to talk about. Here's the pitch, curve inside.
And we're able to sprinkle in some in the high school every now and then. I went from 30 minutes to an hour because they asked me to, you know.
Escobar, pitch is low. Escobar, fielder's choice, a 1-6 and grounded to second. How big is this, Coach? You're down 4-0. You're struggling to get base runners on, even though you've had a couple of opportunities. This pitcher kind of on the ropes here.
You really want to not let that runner score.
This pitch strike called.
Because, again, that 5 runs eliminates the possibility of a grand slam slide tying you or beating you. So.
Wildcats have out-hit Grambling 6-2. Lead 4-0. Losers eliminated. The pitch from Connor. Pass ball inside.
Now Connor is having problems throwing strikes. And, you know, if he could throw strikes at the knees, he could get ground balls. They won't hurt him.
I think Grambling's bullpen is ready.
They better be.
I think the pitcher down there is warmed up and he's ready. The pitch. Ball 4, and it's 2-1 for the Wildcats. So Garcia singled, stole a base, is at second. Escobar's at first. Going to bring up Brian Perez, who walked and struck out. This is a big sequence here, 2-1 and 1 out. Grambling obviously looking for a double play. The Wildcats trying to extend their lead.
And Coach Pierre is staying in the dugout. He's not coming get him.
Well, he's on the top step. I think this may be the last batter. Off the end of the bat, fouls it back. This is the number 5 hitter, Perez. Final game here in day 3. Mother Nature was the dominant feature at the start. Now you've got 3 teams eliminated. And we come down to tomorrow with Southern BAMU at 9. The pitch, low check swing, did not go around. At noon, Bama State will take on the winner of this game. At 12, minimum 2 games. We could have 4 tomorrow.
Let's hope not. Okay, let's not even talk about that. All right.
Well, it's our job to provide the options. Those are the options that are on the table, Coach.
I know, Charles.
I was holding that one up to the last possible moment. Here's a pitch, a long one in the left field. Home run.
That's a 3-runner.
Brian Perez touches them all. Garcia scores. Escobar scores, and it's 7-0 Wildcats.
You know, every time a coach have left a pitcher out there for one more, to try to get one more out, they've been burned. It happened against Southern, but Southern was able to come back. It happened against Grambling right here, and it happened again against somebody else. I can't remember. Ooh, he had a really good swing right there, Charles.
Pitching change coming up. Connor is done. And man, the ball's been flying out of here. We had a grand slam hit early on. 3-run home run here. 7-0. The home run porch, as you can see. That's catered to a bunch of homers today. We'll take a break here. Pitching change coming up for the G-Men.
Building champions for life didn't just happen overnight. Since 1920, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, SWAC, has been in the forefront in leadership and excellence in all our athletic programs. There are very few major sports halls of fame that a SWAC athlete is not a member. Hall of Fame coaches who were stewards and mentors to these elite athletes. Our tradition, our distinction, our legacy. We are the SWAC, building champions for life. The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country, and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Looking at Malik Abdul, 0-1 during the year. Pitches low, ball one. For Abdul, Coach Roger Cador, 19 2/3 innings pitched during the course of the season, 15 strikeouts, 9 walks, 22 earned runs on 33 hits.
Now he struck out a lot for his 19, 15 and 19, not bad.
7-0. Wildcats on 7 hits, the big blow, a 3-run home run by Perez, and now the bullpen getting busy again for Grambling. Just trying to stop this onslaught here. 7 runs, 7 hits for Bethune-Cookman. This is popped up mile high. Is there a play? It looks like it is not.
Didn't hit you on the head, did it?
No. Sure did not. That would be very painful.
Yes, I know.
Well, Coach, you're talking about Connor in between during the break. I know it's tough for Coach Pierre to pull him at that time, but Connor had kind of been all over the place, wasn't he?
Well, he had begun. You know, he was doing good early. And I had mentioned him by the middle of the game, you got to start watching because people come second round in the lineup, you know? And you know, and he was not a kid that was going to – I think if Pierre had said, if I can get 3 good in and out of him, I'll take it. Because that's what Crenshaw did last year.
Yeah.
Don't ask him to give you 4 if you can only get 3. And he asked him to give him more than he probably could have.
Yeah.
You know?
Garcia at the plate for the Wildcats. Pitch inside.
The one thing you have to have – is some kind of game plan as it relates to these kind of pitchers.
Yeah.
They don't have a blueprint that you can go on and that they're going to give you 5-6 innings, you know? You know? And they don't have a history.
And considering this is an elimination game,
yeah,
the margin of error is really smaller.
Smaller. Now, I'm thinking if he had decided, I'd take 3 innings from him.
Garcia with a single to right. Good play at second, but just too much speed and too much ground to cover.
Yeah, he made a good effort.
Yeah, Jarre Parker, ball skipped on him as well. So that's the eighth hit for the Wildcats. This is the bottom of the lineup, Coach. This is the number seven hitter.
Those are your boys.
I mean, this is something to put a circle around. With that single, the last three hitters, Garcia, Reyes, and Olison, have been on base six times. And with Reyes coming up now, Reyes has been on base twice with no average coming into this tournament.
Oh, he got a hit.
And this is going to be a base hit. He's on base three times. Well, the bottom of the lineup getting it done for the Wildcats throughout the lineup. And now with two out, two on for the Wildcats. We don't want to underestimate that because I think, Coach, that might have set the table, you think?
It did. That's where they got that first run from.
Yeah.
You know.
When you have the bottom of the lineup as productive as that, how does that make the rest of the lineup one through six? Make them relax a little bit?
Well, relax a little bit, and they know that they have people on base that they can drive in, you know?
And this is the number nine hitter. Olison reached out an air, made it 4-0, singled, advanced on a wild pitch. Pitch misses ball one. Grambling just two hits, but they had some opportunities early out there. In the third, a double by Valoy with one out. He was stranded. In the fourth, Page, a leadoff double. He was stranded. So Grambling's had some chances, few and far between, but some chances nonetheless, Coach.
Yeah.
How could that take the wind out of the sails?
Well, it still got some wind in the sail because it's just the fifth inning. And, you know, it's no way Coach Pierre's going to let him lay down, and I don't think the player's going to lay down.
Yeah.
You know.
But in terms of momentum, I mean, you don't get – I'm sure he probably knew coming in it was going to be tough against his pitcher, and the chances that you had couldn't cash in.
Right. Well, he knew it was going to be tough anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, all these games going to be tough.
Well, we had a string of one-run games until that last game. 17-1, BAMU eliminated Prairie View.
This could get ugly if he doesn't throw enough strikes.
Yeah, already 7-0. Three in the fourth, three here in the fifth, one in the third. Seven runs in the last three innings for the Wildcats. This pitch is high and inside, and now they're loaded up. And
my
this
man
is
gets
huge.
On base again.
That's what, 3-6. Eight of the nine at bats by the final three in the lineup gotten on base.
Garcia, 8 out of 9?
8 out of 9. Garcia, the number seven hitter, he struck out in his single since twice. So he's 2 for 3. Reyes hit, doubled, and singled on base 3 times. Olison reached on an error, just walked and singled. So out of potential 9 at bats, 8 out of 9. Now that's productive at the bottom.
Yeah.
And now we're at the top.
And the base is low, but you got 2 outs, so you just need to be able to throw strikes here because you got 2 outs, get a ground ball pop up.
And then you got Stevens 0 for 2.
Yeah.
At the top of the lineup.
Well, this guy, the way he's got himself turned, it's going to be tough to hit.
Oh,
you know, he hit him.
He was hit.
And, yeah. And that score, that's 8 runs.
8-0.
He did this guy a favor because the way he's turned, I doubt if he could get the bat hit out.
Now Matthew Garcia, 1 for 3 with a stolen base. Wildcats, 4 runs on 4 hits, 2 walks, a batter hit in this inning. Time called. The catcher, John Garcia, coming out. It's got to be tough, Coach, right here.
Yeah, because it's a danger zone. Full rounder hit you up 10-0. Then some wind really come out of the sail.
Well, we saw Southern come back from 7-0 down. So you can't really say this one is done. But
you
Grambling.
Know, Kate.
I mean, we've seen Grambling battle back. But right now it's 8-0 with Malik Abdul.
Well, they must want they want to take him out.
There comes Coach Pierre.
Yeah, they want to take him out and put someone else in.
So we'll take a break right here. We'll be right back after this here on the SWAC Digital Network.
Building champions for life didn't just happen overnight. Since 1920, the Southwestern Athletic Conference, SWAC, has been in the forefront in leadership and excellence in all our athletic programs. There are very few major sports halls of fame that a SWAC athlete is not a member. Hall of Fame coaches who were stewards and mentors to these elite athletes. Our tradition, our distinction, our legacy. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
You're looking at the lefty Heath Backus, the sophomore from Waverly, Texas, 6'2", 195-pound sophomore. On the mound, Backus 0-2. 10 2/3 innings pitched for the G-men.
Not a lot of innings.
And just trying to get this third out. Bethune Cookman, 8 runs on 9 hits. Man, coming into this tournament, the two newest additions to the SWAC, FAMU and Bethune Cookman. FAMU will live to see tomorrow. And right now, the Wildcats are on their way.
Looks that way.
Well, you look at, if you just look at the stats, Coach, top pitchers, Bama State, Bethune Cookman, FAMU.
The top pitchers?
Top pitching teams. If you look at top 5, 4 or 5 in the league, in the East it's arm heavy, in the West it's bat heavy. And right now, you got Bama State in, you got FAMU in, but Bethune-Cookman is winning. Who would have thought coming into Saturday you got 3 teams from the East, 2 new additions, making it this deep in the tournament. But
I would have believed it.
You would have believed it.
Yeah, because what I noticed about the West, they had no pitching. I keep going back to the pitching thing. You know, they had no pitching.
Here's a wild pitch. A run is in, and it's 9-0.
You know, and if you don't have pitching, you don't have a chance in this tournament. You got me? Because you're going to be tested at some point. You know, and we've seen it. We've seen it right now.
Yeah.
The last 2 innings, 8 runs. Because the starting pitcher had given you all you could get from him. He gave you three good innings.
Yeah.
You know? And he was trying to force feed that baby.
It was 9-0, and now Grambling's trying to hang on for dear life here. You have a runner at third, two out. 9 runs, 9 hits for the Wildcats.
Oh, they're going to score more than 10 runs.
Runners on a second and third, two out.
It may not be this inning, but, you know, there is no way they can stop them because they don't have it. If they did, Coach Pierre would have brought him out. Because he knows he got to get to tomorrow. You got me?
Well, in order for Grambling to see tomorrow, they got a lot has to happen.
And that's why he would be bringing in someone that could stop him.
Here's the 3-1, a base hit in the right center. Two runs are going to score. And it is 11-0, Bethune-Cookman. Wildcats, 7 in this fifth inning.
It's taking the sail out. The wind out of the sail, I'm sorry.
Eleven runs in the last three innings for the Wildcats. And this team has shown the ability to score. They scored 13 against Jackson State on May the 8th, 12 against Alabama A&M. Here's another base hit. Inning continues for the Wildcats. And they're just batting around here, Coach. A single by Escobar. He's on base for the third time. And then Perez, a 3-run home run. In this inning, he's on and at the plate for the second time. Perez walked, homered, struck out. Eleven to nothing, Wildcats. This misses outside, ball one.
And it's tough, man. It's really, I feel for him. But you know what? You got to suck it up. This is competition.
Yeah, the last two games, Coach Riggins, his team gave up 17 against FAMU. His pitch is high. And then obviously for Coach Pierre, Grambling scored 14 against Texas Southern, eliminating TSU. And unless they get something going, unless they get at least a couple of runs the next couple innings, this game could end shortly for the G-men. And we got a wild pitch, runners to second and third.
Coach Pierre mentioned he was hoping that they didn't leave any of those runs against Texas Southern. Well, the thing about the way athletics work in baseball, you can't bring any runs with you from the last game. You got me?
Yeah. You can't take it with you.
You can't take it. You got to create them in the situation you're in now.
Looks like a Santiago Hungria getting up and throwing it. It's going to head into the bullpen from the dugout. Time called is they allow him to get to the bullpen. I mean, Coach, this has to be tough when your season, you've played baseball from the fall, you go through fall ball, then you start in February, you get through the grind of conference play, you get to the tournament, in the last game of your season, you got a score like this right now. I mean, there's still some time left for Grambling, but you talk about winning the sales.
Let me just say this. Even if Grambling scores, they still have to stop Bethune-Cookman from scoring. You got me?
And that's what's concerning Coach Devin Pierre right now. It looks like a pitching change is coming up here, so we'll step aside and tell you about it. 11-0, a 7-run fifth inning for the Wildcats. We'll be back after this on the SWAC Digital Network. Thank you.
In 1920, an athletic league was formed and slowly became one of the leading sports associations in the world of collegiate athletics, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for student athletes and promoting academic excellence. Each SWAC member institution represents a high level of integrity and sportsmanship. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
You are looking at Amir Garrett, the redshirt senior from Bear, Delaware, on the round, on the mound for Grambling. Garrett, 0-1 with 19 appearances during the regular season. Perez at the plate. He had a 3-run home run in this inning. His pitch misses outside.
19 appearances is a lot. Why did he wait so long to use him? You had to try and stop him. You got me?
Yeah. Right now, Bethune-Cookman's getting it done. 11 runs, 11 hits. Big swing and a miss. He's trying to hit that one out of the ballpark. You surprised at the number of home runs that have been hit? You know, it's kind of silent early, but then we've had a grand slam. We've had a 3-run homer here. You surprised at some of the power that these players are flashing here in this ballpark?
Not really.
As a curve misses. Pretty spacious ballpark. It's 320 down the lines. 400 to dead center.
I was trying to figure out what the left center field and right center field might be. They don't have any
signal. See the dimensions there. Pitch misses outside. 7-run fifth inning. Well, right now, Grambling needs at least two in the last two innings and then keep Bethune-Cookman off the board to extend this game beyond the seventh. The check swing, strike called. Count is full, 3-2 here in Birmingham at Regents Field. 11-0. Wildcats.
Big pitch right here. He needs to throw a strike.
Well, instead, it's a bases loaded walk.
Well, another, wow.
12-0.
It's just 12-0?
12-0 on 11 hits.
That don't seem right, but I thought when they hit the double, they had 12. I don't know.
Well, to bring up the first baseman, Boris Pena, doubled, struck out, hit into a 6-4-3 double play. 8 runs in this inning. We're in the top of the fifth inning. Here's a shot fair down the left field line. It's going to score two. And a double here for Pena, and it's 13-0.
It better be 14 if it scored two. Because it was 12. If it scored two, it better be 14.
It's 14, yes, 14-0.
Hey, Charles, I got to check you.
You're right. You are correct. They've batted around trying to keep up with all the numbers.
Yeah, I got
14-0 on 12 hits. Ten runs.
And they're not through.
And a wild pitch is going to bring home another run. 15-0. Runner at third.
Let's hope they don't do what Reggie Williams did with that son. Said, let's call it. They're not going to do it here.
Well, I think that was the case. That was this past Sunday. I think lightning. We had lightning in the area.
I'm talking about when they were at Alcorn.
Oh.
There was no lightning there.
Oh, it was at Alcorn. I thought you were talking about
that's
the game
what,
in Baton Rouge.
Yeah. I'm not talking about the one in Baton Rouge. I'm talking about.
Well, here's a fly ball to shallow left center. Oh! It's dropped. A run is in.
Maybe two. Well, maybe only one.
16-0.
Two runs should have. Well, yeah, it's only one guy on base.
Frederick. It's all coming apart for Grambling here. I mean, just a lazy fly ball.
Well, the concentration have gone now. When you don't throw a lot of strikes, people look. You got me? They go to sleep on you because you're not throwing strikes. You got me? And that's part of the problem when with young people. You know, they can lose their concentration easy.
Looks like we got a pinch hitter.
It's 16-0, though.
16-0. Here in this fifth inning. There's the pitch high, ball one. Man, what a tough way for Grambling here. As Bethune is batted around. And a pinch hitter here. It's going to be Frankie Feebles. Feebles the righty, curve strike called. Feebles, the 6'1 redshirt sophomore from Hialeah, Florida, Mater Academy High School. 16-0, Bethune-Cookman.
Maybe you could go pitch, Charles.
No.
I mean, you can't do any worse.
No, it's
I could go. I mean, let's see my arm. Oh.
No. Coach, we don't want to add any more insurance on you. You got enough insurance as it is.
Okay.
Here's a pitch swing and a miss. It's a wild pitch and a strikeout, and the side is retired. What an inning for Bethune-Cookman. What a nightmare for Grambling. 12-run fifth inning, and the Wildcats are up 16-0. They scored 12 in the fifth, 3 in the fourth, 1 in the third, 16-0. Bethune-Cookman. Grambling needs at least 7 to extend this game beyond the 7. There's some changes coming up. We'll tell you about them as well when we come back here on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Academically, competitively, and athletically to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
back here in Birmingham. 17 men to the plate for the Wildcats in that last half inning. Mack, Gardner, and Valoy, 6-7 and 8 coming up for the G-men. And for interim coach Davin Pierre, that's a nightmarish of an inning. This pitch strike call. And Coach Cater, you called it the last 2 days. Pitching. How much have you got? Quality, quantity. What's important right now at this stage in the tournament? Quality or quantity?
Well, just to have them. I've been there before, so I know what it took. It's going to take pitching. And I told Pierre, and I told everybody that's been coming, pitching is what's going to be. You got to have it.
The number of arms or just a few quality arms?
Yeah, well, a few quality. And you could have quantity, but you got to know how to use them. You can't ask them to go 4-5 innings.
There's a fly ball hooked foul off the bat of Mack.
I think he had Pierre taking the 3 innings from that first kid, we would be looking at a total different situation.
Just kind of piece it together.
He had to be thinking that.
Yeah.
He thought what? You thought that guy was going to give you 4-5 innings?
Pitch misses outside.
You know.
Yeah. I mean, you really have to string it together. And then, too, how much of a factor is it, Coach? You played earlier today over at UAB.
Well, but they were playing pretty good. And I'm not going to use that as an excuse.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were playing pretty good. They were loose. They were doing good. Just keep piecing it. And the team would have accepted that. You got me?
Yeah.
Once that guy got in trouble, then it was too much pressure for them other guy to come in and throw strikes.
One out. Pitch up and away. One down. It'll bring up the first baseman, Aries Gardner. So, again, if the Wildcats win this game, they eliminate Grambling, and we'll have our final four tomorrow beginning at 9. Already you've got 3/4 of it.
All you got to do, sir, is just
Southern FAMU at 9. Bama State will take on the winner of this game at 12. Could be 2 games, as little as 2, as many as 4. That's a pitch swing and a miss.
Are you working the game of Southern tomorrow?
Yeah, I think I'm going to do the 9 a.m. game.
Okay.
I think I'll do the 9, and then Santori will come back, and we'll just kind of see where it goes from there. Let's see where the games take us, Coach.
Let's see where the games crying. Take us. Can you check and see if he's crying over there? Huh? He's crying?
This pitch inside, yeah.
Tell him he's going to be okay.
Well, of course, Grambling interim head coach Davin Pierre. You know, hopefully he'll get the gig. I think that program is rock solid. Just in this game, one bad inning. And, Coach, you talk about winning a tournament from a loser's bracket. It's been done many a time. Prairie View's done it. Texas Southern has done it. When you lose that first game, and Grambling lost that first game. Yeah, they came back and eliminated Texas Southern. What's the key to winning the SWAC tournament from the loser's bracket, especially when you lose that first game?
Well, pitching is to have pitching. In 1991, Jackson beat us, and we had to come back, and we had to win 3 the hard way. We lost the first game, and we had to come out of that loser's bracket. I remember 91 specifically because, you know, I just got my pacemaker put in and wasn't feeling that good. And the kids rallied around it, and we won it 3 the hard way.
Yeah.
And we did it again in 07. We did it several times. But we had arms.
Well, when you talk about Bethune-Cookman, a team, you know, you look at the top pitching teams in the league, most of them on the eastern side. You look at Bethune-Cookman, I mean, obviously it's going to be a major miracle for Grambling to come back. But you look at 2 of the top pitching teams in the conference in Bama State and Bethune-Cookman. How do you think that's going to shake down tomorrow with, you know, obviously Bama State controlling that?
I actually think FAMU got better pitching than Alabama State. I don't like Alabama State's bullpen at all.
Well, it would be Bethune-Cookman, Bama State, FAMU, and Southern.
Yeah, that's the way. Yeah, so, and Alabama State may be fourth on there. They do have two good starters. I like their two good starters. But I don't care much for this bullpen.
So you think the pitching is about even with Bama State and Bethune?
Oh no, Bethune is much better than Bethune has got the best pitching. And then FAMU is two. I think Southern is three and Alabama State is four.
Interesting. From head coach Roger Cator, ranking the pitching staffs that's still alive.
I'm ranking what I think. I'm not saying it is. But I like Bethune-Cookman pitching staff. I think they're going to – if they win, who they play tomorrow?
They'll play Bama State. Got to knock them out twice.
They're going to beat Alabama State tomorrow.
There's a fly ball high in the air to right field.
And the wind is blowing.
The side is going to be retired as Patterson hauls it in. 1-2-3 inning for Vasquez. So we go to the top of the sixth inning. All Bethune-Cookman, 16-0. We'll take a break here. And the top of the lineup for the Wildcats coming up here on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country, and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Chevy is a proud supporter of the SWAC and historically black colleges and universities. Chevy is the sponsor for our starting lineups. And that will be the case tomorrow.
Whoever called me about the doctor I had two pitchers named Doc. One named Doc Holliday, one named Doc Foster. And they both pitched at the same time. So I don't know who else I had doctor to.
Yeah, there was a text that came in and asked about who was the pitcher that you used to call the doctor.
I only call him Doc, not doctor. Maybe early in my career I had called someone doctor, but I don't remember.
Let's see if they respond here. There's a fly ball right side. And it's going to be caught in right, one away. Well, you look at this Grambling team. And you look at the Western Division, Texas Southern, Prairie View. Now, that's Grambling rallies in a major way. Three of the four teams in the West, a race that was so hotly contested down to the final weekend of the season, would be eliminated. Then you've got FAMU. You've got Bama State. You've got Bethune-Cookman. Teams just kind of, you know, went their way and did their thing.
Oh, yeah.
And they're looking at the final four. So for all the talk, you know, one division obviously strong on arms, one strong with the bats. Again, unless Grambling rallies in a major way, it looks like the eastern side will be strong in this 2022 SWAC baseball tournament.
Because of arms.
As the pitch misses.
They had someone to take care of the game at the back end of the game. You got me? somebody to the West have no one other than Southern. And that's why Southern is where they are. You know, it's not by chance.
Lake Fisher at the plate for the Wildcats. Lake Fisher, 6'2", redshirt sophomore, there's a fly ball down the left side and lands out of play. Fisher, the 6'2", redshirt sophomore from Dundee, Florida.
Dundee.
Well, obviously, and I always thought that, you know, can you slug your way to a championship? We've seen, you know, even your Southern teams, good pitching, have the timely hitting. And I thought Jackson State, Texas Southern, a team with 220 stolen bases, I challenge you. And I thought that would keep them alive, a swing and a miss here. But good pitching always thwarts good hitting. That's the old adage, Coach?
Yeah. You know, let's be realistic. Neither Texas Southern, neither Jackson State had any chance of winning, no matter what the stats showed, okay? You know, Michael Robinson wasn't going to be able to steal that many bases to make a difference because his pitching still was terrible. You got me? Omar, best pitchers, got hurt. He would have been a lot better had he had his arms. You got me?
Yeah.
But in his case, injury took away his pitchers. So
and that caught the umpire, too, on that foul ball.
Yeah.
I think if there's one team that's really painful – you know, you look at Jackson State, 12 months ago, they were the talk of the tournament in Huntsville. They went 24-0 in the division. They play their best baseball in the regular season. They get to the postseason. In the last game in three innings, they couldn't close the deal.
Yeah.
Then they come back this year.
But they were hurt this year.
They were hurt this year.
I think we need to make sure they say that because had he had his players, pitchers, he would have still been in the upper echelon. You got me? You know, that's the only thing about him.
It's the pitch up and in. And they got off to a slow start. They had won six in a row coming in, talking about Jackson State. They were the hottest team coming into this tournament.
Yeah. Just, you know, he just lost those pitchers. I think he lost what, five pitchers. That's a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know.
And you're talking about a Jackson State team that just a few years ago won back-to-back tournament titles, played in the Louisiana Regional, beat the number one team in the country, Louisiana, 1-0, and then Louisiana. Played in the LSU Regional.
Right. So, yeah. No, he's but it's tough to go back three times.
Yeah.
I mean, it's tough.
Southern's looking for their third straight tournament title. They're very much right there in the mix. Southern and FAMU, and we all know what happened earlier today. It was 7-0 FAMU, and then the Jaguars woke up, a throwing error, and the Jaguars rallied. But tomorrow's a new day. FAMU will have to beat the Jaguars twice.
It could happen.
Pitches inside.
It could happen.
Matthew Garcia taking first.
You don't want to see. Yeah. It could happen. I've seen it happen.
Yeah. But what does tomorrow bring, Coach, when you've had, you know, obviously FAMU's done for the day. Southern was the first game of the day. So you have both teams off their feet, relaxing a little bit. Does that just wipe away all the stuff that's happened today and yesterday? It's a clean slate.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Everybody's available.
Well, I'm not going to say that. You would, most of everyone, everybody.
Most of your arms are available tomorrow?
Yeah, everybody ain't going to be available. People who care about young people's health, you got me? You wouldn't make their arm be available, you got me?
Well, I guess, okay, well, let me back up. Okay. For FAMU, obviously they lose, and their season's over. So for FAMU, is everybody available? Because they're in the loser's end of it. Or does it come back to your point of it's about health and safety? And you got
to do what's best for the young people. Mm-hmm. If a person throw 60 pitches, I could bring him back in 2 days. You got me?
Yeah.
But 130-some pitching, why would you even think of that?
Yeah.
How could you even think that way?
Christopher Patterson at the plate.
I think part of the reason we were successful is that kids knew that we care about their well-being, okay? We don't want to win at all costs, okay? But we never been with them guys who got to win. They're trying to get jobs, you got me? So there's a little different. I understand.
There's a high fly ball, mile high in the air. It's going to land out of play. Beautiful ballpark here at Regents Field.
It is.
Last year we were in Huntsville. Beautiful ballpark, minor league park there, minor league park here. We're going back to New Orleans, Wesley Barrow Stadium next year. And in case you're wondering, the 2023 SWAC Baseball Tournament returns to New Orleans, Wesley Barrow Stadium.
I'm walking I'm walking to New Orleans.
That's in your backyard, Coach Cador. You won't have far to go. You will not have far to go as you make the trip down I-10. There's a foul straight back.
I was singing a Fats Domino. I'm walking to New Orleans.
Well, how would you assess, Coach, you know, the tournament in it's been for several years at Wesley Barrow? Just the atmosphere, facility, they're going to obviously do some modifications to it. Just the facility overall. You got UNO next door. You got the indoor batting cage. It drains wonderfully. I mean, we had like a couple of years ago, I remember we had like an hour straight deluge. All they did was cover, and it's completely turf. Even the pitching mound, it's brown, but it's turf. All they did is cover that. And once you uncover that in 15 or 20 minutes, once you get loose, you can play.
Yeah.
Great, great drainage there.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It makes it easy because we don't have a big staff with the SWAC. You got me? So you need to mobilize your staff, mobilize it by getting them to do the things that are essential and not have to worry about the field. That's a big headache that's lifted.
Well, Escobar draws a walk.
Boy, it ain't over with. It's two out, though.
And we got a pinch hitter here. Brayton Gantby. Gantby, the lefty. The 6'1 redshirt sophomore from Naples, Florida, is pitch swing and a miss.
That's a good living area.
Coach, I got that text. Holiday was the pitcher that they were referring to.
Yeah, Doc Holiday.
I remember Doc Holiday.
Yeah, it wasn't Doc, it was Doc.
Here was a base hit in the left field, and the bases are loaded with two out. Well, the Wildcats batting around.
But I had two doctors on there, and they were best friends. One day they were going to the cafeteria, and I said, Doc Holiday. Dr. Foster, which he wanted to be a medical doctor, and Doc Holiday was a gunslinger. I always wanted to give my kids some kind of name, nickname, you know?
Nicknames?
Well, I grew up in an era where nicknames were big.
What was your nickname?
Baby. I was the baby.
Oh, the baby of the family?
There you go.
Oh, okay. Curve strike called. nothing, the Wildcats.
And the news people used to trick me, ask me, can you tell me what's Doc Foster's name? I never knew his first name. I only knew Doc Foster.
Oh, yeah.
Huh?
Just two hits for the Tigers.
But three errors.
Yeah, three errors.
Oh, that one and a bunch of walks.
17 to the plate, 12 run fifth inning. Curve misses.
Bunch of walks.
Yep, the walks.
Hit batters. That all of the stuff will kill you.
You take away the one bad inning, you still got a game. And what is it like coaching that? I mean, you talk about you've been there. You just look at that Grambling dugout. You just see the body language is completely different. Just what's going through the mind of those guys down there?
They're depressed right now. They're dejected. I mean, you know, it's all over. They figure, you know, we got to score 16 runs to win, 17 to win. I mean, that's you got two innings to do it. That's a lot.
And we go to the bottom of the sixth inning. Grambling keeps the Wildcats off the board, 16-0. Coach, another question's come in from a former player. We'll talk about that when we come back from Birmingham. 16-0. Wildcats get the win. They eliminate Grambling, and they'll take on Bama State tomorrow at noon. We've got Southern and FAMU at 9, and Bama State versus the winner of this game. We'll be back after this timeout on the SWAC Digital Network. Welcome back to Birmingham, Alabama. We started with 8. 3 teams were eliminated today, and unless Grambling gets a whole bunch of stuff going, we're going to be down to 4. Jackson State, Texas Southern, Prairie View have been eliminated. Who you got left? Southern, FAMU tomorrow. You've got Grambling. You've got Bethune, Cookman, and then you got Bama State. This pitch strike called, and we're underway in the bottom of the 6th inning. Frederick leading it off for the G-Men. A 12-run 5th inning for the Wildcats. The big blow in this game. They sent 17 to the plate. 3-run home run in there. Pitch swing and a miss. Coach got another text.
They're coming in.
They're coming in from a Joseph Rankin says hello. And former pitcher, talk about him.
Who?
Joseph Rankin. Remember you talked about Coach Rankin?
Yeah, like I said, he was one of my pitchers. Got him from a junior college in Southwest, right there on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi. What was the name of the JC? Southwest? I don't remember the college, but that's where he came from. And really pitched. He was on the staff where we had some really good arms. And Joseph did two things. He started some games. And when we needed reliever to close, he was a closer.
It's a solid arm.
Solid arm. Oh, no, good pitch, too smart.
There's a fly ball in the left center field. Is it going to be caught in center, one out? A lot of folks are happy, Coach, to see you up here and just sharing your knowledge, sharing your stories, sharing strategy. And you've been dead spot on.
I've been dead spot on.
You've been dead spot on. In other words, you've been right.
I'll try to do it. And they probably, you know, some of the players, ex-players been texting me, Coach, you had it right all along.
Paige, you know, at the plate for Grambling. You know, Grambling early in this game had a couple of opportunities. Paige had a double to lead off. He was stranded. Yeah. Paige, if Grambling could have found a way to win this game, trust me, he would be available for tomorrow. But
yeah,
Paige shows you his versatility, playing left, and pretty good hitter, too.
Yeah.
great pitcher, pitcher of the year.
In a way, I'm glad they did win because he can go now off into maybe pro ball and not be dead, have a dead arm, you know?
Yeah.
You know.
Where do you see him, Coach? Because obviously pitcher of the year and now base hit here.
He may be better as a player, as a position player.
But do you see him on the mound in his future?
No. It's too difficult the way baseball is right now.
John Garcia stands in.
It's just too difficult. Baseball is so difficult now.
What makes it difficult? Is Garcia's 0-for-2 at the plate?
It's a different organization. They're doing things different. Analytics and everything.
The analytics, yeah.
Yeah, it makes it's a different game.
This made it harder?
Yes.
Pitch misses outside.
And they cut out so many teams that you can't don't have a way to give people opportunity, you know?
Yeah, during the pandemic, a lot of minor league baseball was just downsized big time.
Yeah, the commissioner's office downsized.
Do you see that coming back anytime soon?
No.
There's a fly ball right side. And, of course, you said it earlier.
Let me tell you why. It's saving owners money.
Yeah.
And they still got enough good players. You got me?
Yeah.
Remember, the influx of young talent coming out of the Latin America, it's just amazing. You know.
So even with the downsize, there's enough talent out there to still field the teams. Here's a chopper in the hole, and it's a base hit. Now, Grambling's showing a little fight here with a couple on.
They're not dead yet. Fight to the end. Let me see how many lives the Tigers got.
Well, you talked about the lives of the Jaguars. How many is that?
Too many to count. More than you can count.
Jaguars will be taking on FAMU, who got off the mat.
Sutton has got two things going for him. They got Taj Porter going for him. And they got the coach, Chris Crenshaw, who have ice in his vein.
The Jaguars have come back twice. Down 4-1 to Jackson State. 7-0 against FAMU. They came back in the championship game last year, winning the title in Huntsville against Jackson State. This team just doesn't have quit in them. There's the pitch strike call to Trevor Hatton, 0-for-2.
You know, it's just something about a program with tradition, a winning tradition, you know. It's something that kids feel, whether or not they can see it, you know, they can feel it, you know.
Yeah.
And
there's a ground ball to short. The throw across low, the scoop.
What a pick.
And it is
Wilson
there.
Pickett.
Side is retired. Let's take a look at that play, Coach.
He did it like Wilson Pickett.
The short hop on the throw.
I don't know what the shortstop was doing.
Look at this glove at first. Oh, that's on the short hop. Terrific. At first, side is retired. We go to the seventh inning. All Bethune-Cookman, 16-0. We'll be back with the seventh here on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life. In 1920, an athletic league was formed and slowly became one of the leading sports associations in the world of collegiate athletics, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for student athletes and promoting academic excellence. Each SWAC member institution represents a high level of integrity and sportsmanship. We are the SWAC, building champions for life.
Hungria on the mound for Grambling as we go to the seventh inning. 16 runs, 13 hits for Bethune-Cookman. The 12-run fifth inning, the story in this game, where they sent 17 to the plate. There's a base hit to start out the seventh inning for the Wildcats. Leading it off for Bethune-Cookman here in the seventh. Kobe Twinton, the redshirt sophomore from Grand Forks, North Dakota.
Ooh.
With a base hit.
He came for a long ways.
Yeah, Grand Forks. This is inside ball one.
Maybe his parents are watching tonight.
Garcia at the plate. Jeremy Garcia, the third baseman. On base twice, a wild pitch. The base is loaded, made it 15 to nothing.
You know what gets me? The pitchers are throwing so many balls so far away from the strike zone. That can't be, you know what I'm saying?
Here's a shot in the right center field, and this ball's gonna drop for a base hit. Extra bases, second and third. And Garcia on base for the third time, a double here. So second and third, nobody out. Well, the Wildcats just keep it coming. The 15th hit for the Wildcats. Second and third, nobody out. At the plate, Frankie Feebles, the redshirt sophomore.
You can't tell him make outs.
There's a wild pitch, and runner will not try to score. Could have, but decided not to. I think it's a good deal there.
Yeah, no, that the coach held him up to. No, they're not trying to. They're not trying to humiliate Grambling.
Well, we'll talk about that, coach, because the difference between that and just playing the game. You got at this point, obviously. Players who don't see a lot of action, giving them some tournament experience.
Yes.
They want to go out there and perform, whether for themselves, family, friends, coaches, or whatever.
Yes.
Where's that fine line there in a game like this?
No, they're not going to try to stop him from hitting the ball, okay?
Yeah.
They'll let him hit, but this is a situation you don't want to take a chance. You could have scored, but suppose there's a collision and you get the guy hurt. You got me?
Yeah.
It's not worth it, so that's why. The coach held him up at third on that ball hit to right center field, okay? Mm-hmm. So he's not trying to run up the scores, but they're not going to tell the kids who are swinging the bat not to try and get hit, okay? Because it's the pitcher job to get him out.
Oh, there's a fly ball in the deep left field, and this ball is going to go. Three-run home run for Feebles.
See, you can't tell a kid not to swing the bat. And they don't want to hurt him. You see, they're not trying to do a lot of celebrating.
19-0.
You know, not a lot of celebrating. Not a good swing.
Wilkinson, a ground ball to third. Was it a line shot to third? Yep, one out. Let me take a look at it here.
Let's see, that was so short. Yeah, I hit that one pretty good.
Yep, good caught a third, one away. Well, Bethune Cookman, head coach Jonathan Hernandez. He was named Wildcats coach August 14, 2018.
Mm-hmm. Bethune Cookman won a game already, right?
Yep.
That's going to be their second win, which is good.
Yeah, they beat Grambling 4-3, lost to Bama State 8-7, and winning big here. This pitch strike called. Hernandez brought in the most accomplished recruiting class in school history. The 2019 signees were ranked 59th, according to Perfect Game, the highest ever for the Wildcats.
That's not bad.
There's a foul straight back.
That's not bad.
59th.
Yeah.
And, of course, along with their softball program, their baseball program was on the shelf due to COVID. They had to really, you know, fight back.
Yeah.
This pitch misses outside.
Oh, yeah.
And, of course, the athletic director, Bethune-Cookman, a former NBA great, Reggie Theus.
Reggie Theus, the AD?
Reggie Theus is the AD and men's basketball coach.
And the basketball, okay.
There's a fly ball in the right center field. This ball is well hit, and it's all the way to the wall. Extra bases here, a double at least. So a double for the Wildcats here in the seventh inning.
Well.
A double by Lake Fisher.
He hit that ball almost. It was on the, almost on the ground. That was a good low pitch he hit.
And Reggie Theus was named athletic director, and he's men's basketball coach.
Not bad.
Nineteen to nothing. Strike called.
Now, you got to give this umpire some credit. He is beginning to try and elevate the zone just a little more to try and help get the game moving. You got me?
Yeah, Matthew Garcia at the plate. Misses outside. Well, Coach, I didn't know that you were, speaking of basketball, you were an assistant basketball coach at Southern University.
Yes, sir.
How was that experience like?
It was a good experience. I enjoyed it, to be honest with you.
Who was the head coach? Who was your head coach?
Carl Stood and Andy Stoglin.
Andy Stoglin, coach at Jackson State.
Yes, sir. Yeah, it was a good experience.
What years was those? And that was hit
80
by,
to 84.
80 to 84. And I remember Ben Jobe, of course.
Yes.
The late Ben Jobe, the late great Ben Jobe.
Yeah. Really successful coach. We had Robert Hopkins came in there too.
Bob Hopkins, yeah, he was at Grambling. I remember right. Bob at Grambling and then Southern.
Right. Yep.
And, of course, Roman Banks, the current athletic director at Southern University, was also a former
head coach. Tommy Green, too.
Tommy Green. Very well-dressed.
Yeah.
Dapperly dressed, Tommy Green. Like Tommy Green. Boy, some characters in this conference. We can talk all night about just the history.
How is Coach Stribling?
I've seen Coach Stribling around. You look at Coach Stribling, just the dapper dress.
Uh-huh.
All the suits. Longtime coach at Mississippi Valley. Here's a ground ball to third. Throw to second for 1-5-4 and three.
There you go. The umpire is retired. Call him out, get him out. They're not going to argue that. You got me?
Let's take a look at it here. Grambling turned some double plays early. 5-4 and.
Yeah. Good.
Inning over. We go to the bottom of the seventh inning. Four hits for the Tigers. They're down 19-0. Bottom seven coming up here on the SWAC Digital Network.
The SWAC, considered the premier HBCU conference in the country, and currently ranks among the elite conferences in the nation. With this list of 12 elite schools, each contributing to the growth of the Southwestern Athletic Conference, academically, competitively, and athletically, to become the preeminent conference in the nation. The SWAC, building champions for life.
Don't get into that about this.
Kirk Cricket is keeping you connected to the things that matter most with the best plans, smile-worthy deals, and a reliable nationwide network. Visit your local Cricket store today. We are completing game day three. We started with 8. We're going to be down to 4 by the time this inning's over with. Here's a foul ball here. And back-to-back games in which they're one-sided. FAMU eliminated Preview 17-1. And in this game, a 12-run fifth inning in which Bethune-Cookman sent 17 to the plate, and they lead 19-0.
We did mention that as we go into the games, more games we play, more laps, more runs.
There's a chopper foul. All right, Coach, so let's kind of give the fans a tease of what we can expect tomorrow. 9 o'clock, we know that matchup, Southern FAMU. Southern wins.
I don't expect a high-scoring game.
You expect a low score?
It'll be some scoring, but it's not going to be lopsided.
Will it be 8-7 around that score?
I'm not going to get into that.
Here's a shot to second on a hop.
One out. But I think we'll see that. But
What's the keys for both teams? The key for Southern to winning is?
They got to get a pitcher, go give them four innings, and then they got to get – 2-out hit, and then they got to make adjustment at the plate.
All right, so the key for FAMU winning is?
They got to get the same thing. Pitchers got to get him, go give him 4-5 innings, if it's possible, and then they're going to have to get key hit with runners on scoring position.
This misses outside here, ball one.
You know, they're not going to be able to make errors and win. Pitcher's not going to be able to walk people and win.
There's a ground ball foul down the left field line. Do you think mentally that carryover effect from that 7-0 lead that FAMU had?
I'm not going to get into that. Tomorrow is another day.
So tomorrow's another. We'll talk about it tomorrow.
These young kids, you actually think that they're going to think about that? They forgot it soon it was over with.
Yeah.
You know.
So wipe the slate clean.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, it's going to be a good game. You know, Southern can't sleep on their hand and expect to beat them.
And Southern's had two come-from-behind wins. They were down 4-1 to Jackson State, down 7-0 to FAMU. So the Jaguars have been playing upstream here in this tournament. We'll see what tomorrow brings.
They have a coach with ice running through his veins.
Of the matchups, obviously, you know, Bethune, Bama State, which is more of a chess match where it's going to slow down quite a bit? FAMU Southern or Bama State and Bethune?
Which one is going to slow down more?
Which one is more of a chess match? You know, in chess, if you move pieces.
Yeah, I know about chess. They both are going to be chess matches, in my opinion.
It's a pitch swing and a miss. And the Tigers are down to their final out. Well, let's give Grambling their due, Coach, because obviously they lost to this Bethune team 4-3. Shamar Page threw one bad pitch. They were down 4-1, climbed back to make it 4-3. They eliminated Texas Southern, and obviously a tough way to end it here.
Oh, yeah, it's very tough. And for Pierre's first year, he did pretty good. You know, he's going to finish the season with 26-31. And that's not that bad, you know. And let's hope that they'll see fit to hire him, give him the job. You know, they may open up and interview other people. I don't know. You just never know.
Yeah. Cam Holland at the plate, and of course, Grambling's fairly new athletic director, former assistant AD at Southern, Dr. Travian Scott. He's here.
I know him very well.
So he'll have a decision to make with his baseball program.
He literally grew up under me. So. But I know your president over there pretty good.
President Gallo?
Yes.
Cam Holland hit 143 during the season with 5 runs batted in. There's a fly ball into center field.
He hit that one pretty good.
And this ball is going to be caught. And that's going to do it. So our final four has been set. 19-0. Bethune-Cookman eliminates Grambling. So now we started with 8. Now we're down to 4. Tomorrow at 9 o'clock, it will be Southern and FAMU. The Rattlers have to beat the Jaguars twice. Bethune-Cookman eliminates Grambling. And it's Bama State and Bethune-Cookman at 12. And the Wildcats have to eliminate the Hornets twice. Full day, at least 2 games of baseball, could be 4, depending on how things go. We'll have it all covered for you beginning at 9 o'clock tomorrow. Southern, FAMU, a second go-round. Started with 8, down to 4. Jackson State, Texas Southern, Prairie View, and Grambling have been eliminated. That'll do it for day 3 of the 2022 SWAC Baseball Tournament from Birmingham. For our producers, James Crenshaw, on the cameras, Dez Rogers, Lauren Sutton, Roosevelt Smith. For the Hall of Famer, Roger Cato, I'm Charles Edmond. Enjoy your Friday. Get ready for Saturday, tomorrow at 9 o'clock. Southern FAMU Network.
In 1920, an athletic league was formed and slowly became one of the leading sports associations in the world of collegiate athletics, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Today, the SWAC is looking towards the next century, growing, supporting, and transforming our intercollegiate sports activities for students.